Hi everyone, Omar is here. It's the end of August and you know what happened this week, but back in 1995, Windows 95 launched and changed everything. So I guess it's the perfect time for what some of you might call a completely unreasonable experiment. Let's see if Windows 95 can run on today's hot hardware. On bare metal, of course. We're going to use a Ryzen 9 9900X configuration, the same one you might have already seen running Windows 98 in my last video. And while we're at it, we're taking this neat PCIe-to-PCI enclosure from StarTech for a spin. This is the PATCHEM2PCI4 model. It takes a single PCIe X1 slot and gives you four classic PCI slots in exchange. If you really need to use a PCI card in a modern PC, a simple PCIe to PCI adapter will get the job done. But that's a one-for-one slot exchange, and it only works with low-profile cards without any restrictions. This enclosure, on the other hand, gives you four slots and supports full-height cards. Now, this specific model only fits half-length PCI cards. The full-length version costs just $20 more, and honestly, I wish I'd ask StarTech for that one, since my Voodoo 2 cards are begging for more space. In the comments, a few of you noticed it's not exactly a cheap gadget. You're right, it's mainly built for the industrial market, and anything industrial usually comes with a different price tag. Before StarTech sent this one over, I was actually looking at a cheapware 2-slot enclosure from AliExpress, that it's not bigger than an optical drive. But I'm glad I didn't buy it, because there is a tiny but important thing missing from the cheaper version. A redriver chip to boost and stabilize the PCIe signal. Why does the signal even need boosting? Well, both designs use a PCIe X1 dummy card to connect to the motherboard, then pass the signal through a cable to the enclosure. But here's the catch, sending a PCI Express signal over a cable isn't trivial. Some chips just don't generate a strong enough signal to maintain integrity over, let's say, a 1 meter cable. And it's not just about resistance in the wire. At high frequencies, we are also dealing with impedance mismatches, which can cause reflections and signal loss. And honestly, details like this, whether it's about resistance or just how a simple cable behaves, make you realize there is always something new to learn. And that's where Brilliant, the sponsor of this video, comes in. I like to think of it as a gym membership, but for your brain. Brilliant makes learning interactive and hands-on, with courses in electricity, circuits, math, computer science, and plenty more. Each course walks you through the concepts step by step, so instead of just memorizing formulas, you actually understand how things work. Complex topics are broken down into bite-sized challenges, so you can build real skills and make progress, even if you had only got a few minutes to spare. So if you're curious like me and want to keep learning something new every day, head to brilliant.org/omores, scan the QR code on the screen or click the link in the description. You can start learning for free, and using my link gets you 20% off an annual premium subscription. Alright, if you watched my previous video, you'll remember that the big issue with this AM5 build was that Windows 98 or Windows Millennium couldn't boot from the onboard SATA controller. Normally SATA works fine and is very reliable, but in this case it ended with an anti-kern error. My workaround was to use a PCI to SATA adapter, but it turns out we can actually boot from NVMe drives as well, as long as the partition stays within the first 8.4 gigabytes. Since we're running Windows 95A, that's not really a problem anyway, because the initial release doesn't support FAT32 file system and is limited to 8.4 gigabytes on a single drive. I tested it with an NVMe drive and it booted to just fine like Windows 98, but in the end I preferred sticking with my PCIe to SATA adapter and a regular SATA drive so I can move data around more easily. To test it, I used the same installation files from my previous Windows 95 video, the one where I walk you through the entire setup process on an Intel 13th gen configuration. So if you're interested in installing it yourself, every step is shown in that video, so make sure to check it out. Now, to boot into Windows 95, this time I used an SSD that had Windows 3.1 on it. I copied over the Windows and program files folders plus the autoexec, bat, and MS-DOS sys files, all of which I had previously saved in a zip archive. The partition had already been made bootable with Windows 95 boot floppy, so the system files were fine. However, I forgot to copy config sys, or at least to update it, because it was still loading the HIMEM.SYS driver from Windows 3.1. No big deal though, Windows 95 started up fine with the older version of HIMEM.SYS. It detected the new hardware and I was even able to install Nvidia drivers for my 7900GS GPU. But there was this little problem, RAM was limited to only 62 MB. It actually took me a couple of hours to figure out why. Once I updated HIMEM.SYS, Windows 95 recognized all the RAM available, which in this setup is 1.7 GB. And yes, Rudolf Low's PATCHEM was already installed. Honestly though, that's way more RAM than Windows 95 will ever need. Now let's talk about graphic cards. In my previous Windows 95 video, I used a PCIe-ATI Radeon 9250, which worked fine. But of course, I wanted to try something more powerful like this Nvidia 7900GS GPU or the Quadro FX 4500 I've shown you here before. I was always under the impression that the Nvidia 8269 drivers wouldn't work with Windows 95, let alone with the 95A version, but surprisingly the core driver does work. All I had to do was to load the files from the control panel and that was basically it. At the next restart, Windows 95 went straight into full HD. Now, this compatibility is also dependent on your specific hardware. It relies on how your BIOS allocates resources for the GPU, so don't expect it to work exactly the same on every single system. This time it was surprisingly easy, but there are a few issues. First, the driver expects Internet Explorer 6, which can't be installed on Windows 95. Because of this, the Nvidia control panel won't run at all. This, along a few other missing components, triggers some error messages during startup. The good news is that these are easy to fix. You just need to search for the text of the error message in the registry and delete the entries that try to load the failed Nvidia components. Another issue is a graphical glitch whenever a DOS window opens. I'm pretty sure that can be fixed, but I'm still looking into it. Aside from that, the core performance is fantastic, 2D and GDI rendering is rock solid, everything feels fast and responsive on screen, and the Direct3D performance is excellent. So yeah, I think we've got a winner here. Now let's talk about going online. I posted this build on Reddit and people went crazy. Not sure why, it's not the first time I've shared something like this. Anyway, the most upvoted comment was about the user interface, the general consensus. Well, less is more when it comes to aesthetics. Now, some folks ask if this thing can actually go online. Well, of course it can. Windows 95 came out right as the internet was starting to take off. It includes built-in TCP/IP support and some later versions even shipped with Internet Explorer pre-installed, which, as you might know, eventually got Microsoft into some legal trouble. To get connected, all you need is a PCI Ethernet card. The odds of finding Windows 95 drivers for one, I'd say about 90%. And thanks to this enclosure, setup was super straightforward. I used a basic Realtek 8139D adapter and I got online without a hitch. For browsing, I went with RetroZilla 2.3. This is a new release from 2025 that comes with updated certificates that helps more websites to load. But let's be real, it can't work miracles. Under the hood, it's basically as capable as Firefox 2 from 2006. Now, if you're on Windows 98 with kernel X, you can run some newer browsers. But on Windows 95, this is as good as it gets. Now, is it safe to go online with Windows 95? Well, I've been doing this for years, practically asking to get a virus or have someone hack into my network through Windows 95 or 98 or even XP, just so I could make a video about it, but nothing has ever happened. I want to dive too deep into security today, but the short answer is Windows 95 isn't directly exposed to the internet. All its traffic is filtered to a modern Linux-based router, so we're good. Finally, let's talk about sound. I tested quite a few PCI sound cards with the StarTech enclosure, and as expected, they were all detected and the drivers installed just fine. But getting proper sound in DOS is a completely different story. Windows 98 includes a Sound Blaster emulation layer, which was tuned for the newer Windows Driver Model, or WDM. That means sound cards with WDM drivers can still perform well with those games as you launch them inside Windows, even if the card doesn't work in pure DOS. On Windows 95, though, if a sound card can't work in pure DOS, chances are it won't work in Windows either. I covered this in detail in a previous video, so definitely check that out. There are a few exceptions though, like the Aureal Vortex cards, which have some driver magic that makes them work surprisingly well with those games. Since Windows 95 doesn't support WDM drivers, I had to go with an Aureal card, and there aren't many options left these days. The good news is, having an Aureal card definitely brings accelerated HD audio in Windows. The big question is, will it actually work with those titles on such modern hardware like this AM5 build with a Ryzen 9 9900X CPU? Well, yes, it works. This is Network Q Rally DOS game from 1996, and we can definitely hear sounds. MIDI doesn't work, unfortunately, but honestly, you're not missing much. The MIDI on these cards was never that great to begin with. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and a big thank you to Arctic and Kingston for providing parts for this AM5 build. We'll get back to them in the next episode. Omores out. Yeah.